Hello, employees and good friends of mine. Don't worry, this will be Photoshopped later. It's going to be standing room only. Check me out on Instagram. I want to thank everybody for coming in and letting me talk a little bit today. My name is Michael Chasen. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Class Technologies, and we add teaching and learning tools to Zoom. But it's really much more about that. When you take a look at the fundamental changes that have taken place over the last 9 or 12 months throughout society, you can't reflect on that without looking back in our past. Here's a picture of a school back in 1918 during the Spanish flu. You can see everybody is wearing masks. At least they weren't debating that back then. Not so good with the social distancing. But this is an actual image coming out of California at the schools at that time. And it's important to study the Spanish flu in this moment so we can understand not only what's happening in our society today and specifically within education, but what's going to happen after this pandemic, what comes next. The impact of the 1918 pandemic has been studied for over a century. The impact to global society mirrors much of the impact seen today. For public health, the 1918 pandemic socialized medicine throughout Europe, starting in Russia. It actually launched the alternative medicine craze in the United States, and it really started to have a focus economically on income inequality, which widened after the Spanish flu. And that led to several disastrous things going on around the world. From in South Africa, it exasperated segregation and apartheid, and it laid the groundwork for the Great Depression, and eventually, ultimately, played a part in leading us into World War II. Now it isn't all gloom and doom. The important thing for us to ask ourselves is, okay, well, now that we've all faced this fundamental transformation in education, what happens next? How will COVID have changed the world? And you can't expect there to have been hundreds of thousands of teachers and now millions of students that have gone through online classes full-time and not expect that to fundamentally change the structure of our education system. And that we can use this opportunity to drive positive change to education structures and systems. And there are a couple of predictions out there of what's going to happen next. We think that the global edtech spend will clearly increase substantially over the next 5 or 10 years. Remote work is going to become normal. And really, I think the equity of learning is going to be exposed. And you're really now going to have a system where we've seen the success of utilizing technology and online learning that can truly lower cost and increase access to education, and therefore truly change the way the world learns. So we launched Class just 10 months ago. And to give you just some sense of what we've heard from different institutions and the amount of momentum that we've seen, the amount of institutions that are looking for taking this opportunity and really having it lead to substantial change in their own institutions. Since we started, we've now had over 20,000 inbound leads from different institutions around the world that are looking at utilizing this type of technology to improve synchronous learning. Even though our product was only released just about 8 weeks ago, we're in over 500 active sales discussions throughout higher ed and K-12, over 250 corporations that are talking to us about using our technology in their corporate training. And we're now already launching in countries with over 16 international resellers. Now, to step back, I know I don't need to explain to anybody here that COVID has forever changed the world of education. COVID caused every single institution around the world to go online, trained every single teacher and student in what it's like to take an online course. But now, maybe or hopefully as we near the end of COVID, though, schools are looking to still utilize this technology and this expertise they gained to allow for more flexible options for future learners and faculty, to increase access to education, and to actually continue to innovate with their education models. And now, a little bit of backdrop. The reason that I got involved in starting to look at synchronous technology and how it could truly change the world was I was back home during the pandemic. And I have three small children. My daughter was in third grade, my son was in eighth grade, my older daughter was in 10th grade, and they were all home on Zoom. And I saw the problems that they were having engaging with their teachers. And in fact, back in the beginning, if you remember, when schools were going online, the teachers weren't having the full class time. My kids maybe spent an hour in Zoom a week. The teachers had reduced their class time from 3 to 4 hours a week to maybe just 30 minutes to an hour. And I asked their teachers, I said, what's going on? Why are you having trouble engaging the students? And why are you reducing the class time? And they said, look, Zoom is great for lectures. And it's great for group discussions. But we do a lot more than that in the classroom. We take attendance. We hand out assignments. We do work live in class. We give tests or quizzes. We might proctor those exams. We talk one-on-one with the students to help them during the class time. We might have group presentations, as well as using the internet or watching videos. So about 60% of what we do in the physical classroom doesn't translate online with Zoom. Well, prior to starting class, I was the co-founder and CEO of Blackboard, a company I worked at for over a decade. So I had some experience in the edtech and e-learning space. And I was also aware that Zoom had a software development kit, something not widely known by a lot of people because Zoom wasn't truly a platform yet. So I took that platform and I got together with a bunch of developers that I'd worked with previously at Blackboard that were experts in building synchronous and asynchronous learning technology. And we took that Zoom SDK and we added to it teaching and learning tools, student engagement functionality, attendance and ID verification, proctored exams, seating charts, and class management tools. We have now built the first essential synchronous learning app that lets teachers deliver an in-person classroom experience online. But to truly understand this, to truly understand how this technology is going to change the world, I think it's best for me to just show it to you. So when you talk about what the class of the future looks like, or how schools are going to work to improve having a big synchronous component to their traditional classes or move more of the programs online, I think a lot of it's going to be in programs and products like Zoom, and probably mostly Zoom. So if you're using class technology and you're familiar with Zoom, now right from within Zoom, students can pull up a syllabus and engage with the faculty and engage with their instructors and fellow students around the content that the instructor is showing. A teacher, after giving a lecture, can go ahead and say, okay, we're going to do an assignment live in class. I want you to, and it's due in 25 minutes or due the end of class. Or the teacher could say, okay, you know, I'm going to launch a quiz or a test. We're going to take this live right now. I'm going to go ahead and give this quiz on Romeo and Juliet, all right from within Zoom. And when they're done with this, of course, it automatically grades that, and that goes right into the grade book. Zoom has polling, but we enhanced that. We made interactive polls, anonymous polls, all the different ways that students can truly engage to be active in the class discussion. And if a school's already using a LMS like Blackboard or like Instructure or Moodle, you can pull that right within Zoom as well. Now, Zoom, of course, has a share screen, but we enhanced that. We added a presenter mode, so that means that instructors could actually stand in front of the content they're sharing like they would in a real class and point to the different items, just like they'd be standing at the front of the classroom. We brought forward the whiteboard to make it easier for people to deploy. And one of the key things, in fact, one of the top features that instructors are taking a look at when they're examining our products is browsing the web. So, one of the problems, a lot of K-12 schools in particular, they license third-party content that they want their teachers to be able to use in class. And my daughter's class, my daughter who's in third grade, the teacher does this, and every day in class they say, okay, now minimize Zoom and load a web browser, and you're going to go to mathblaster.com and log in. And they lose half the class every single time. My daughter runs out, we lost the teacher, I can't find the class, or they go to the wrong website. So we built in a full browser right within Zoom, so the teacher can actually type mathblaster.com, click share with class, and it pushes that to all the students. And then the students can log in and each interact with the website on their own, not like the typical share screen you're used to. And then when the teacher wants to send them somewhere else, they can very easily go ahead and say, okay, we're going to go to wikipedia.org, click share with class, and send the student to there. So building a full interactive web browser right from within the classroom experience. And then we did the same thing with video. So the teacher can say, you know what, we're all going to watch a video together, and I'm going to control the playback, so all of us here in this room are watching it at the same time. Or they can say, okay, you know what, it's a long video, I'm going to let the students watch it at their own pace. And lastly, of course, a lot of content is handed out in classes, so when you're handing out files for students to look at, right now, if you were in Zoom, you'd have to just very slowly scroll up a document and hope everyone could read it at the same pace. Where we built in the ability to share files, so those files can be pulled up right from within Zoom, and they can easily be downloaded or read or printed, and if they're Google Docs, even have everyone work on them together, all from within Zoom. But when you're talking about redefining the classroom of the future, it's not just about adding teaching and learning tools to an existing meeting platform. We also looked at fundamentally changing the way the faculty and the students engage in the platform. So we took the instructor out of the grid view and we put them on top of what we call the instructor podium. And we developed this idea of front of class, where the teacher could say, okay, I want these teaching assistants to be at the front of the class so everybody knows who to speak to during class time. Or you could say, okay, actually, you students, you're going to be presenting today. I want you at the front of the class and leading the class in some discussion. A lot of schools we're talking to are going back in some kind of a hybrid format. And so we incorporated with Zoom rooms and also third-party cameras so that the teachers can set up a dedicated camera in class. So some people can be connecting via Zoom, and otherwise you can see what's going on in class time with some people there in person and some people remote. And we improve the way that the students actually can raise their hand in class and really try to replicate that physical classroom experience online. One of the things we heard from teachers was it was actually very hard when they were lecturing to give a readout and get an understanding of the feedback of the students, especially if there was, you know, 50 or 100 kids in your class spanning multiple pages. So we added feedback so the students could go ahead and select dedicated feedback that only the instructor could see. So a student might say, hey, you're speaking too quickly, which I know I often do, or they might say, hey, I don't understand this. And the teacher can just look out over the video feeds and say, oh, wait a minute, I better slow down, or I better explain this topic in a little bit more detail. We enhanced the chat. We wanted the chat to be a live part of the class experience. You know, with so many tools being able enabled for the students and teachers to use in the class, this is a feature that often gets lost. But we want there to be an active discussion besides just the live talking that goes on within Zoom. So we made the chat a lot more like Instant Messenger and gave the instructor direct control over it. So they can, during class live, say, you know what, I'm giving a lecture, I don't want anyone talking. Or they can say, wait a minute, if you have questions, go ahead and text the TAs. Or, okay, you're working on group projects together, we're gonna go ahead and let you chat with your fellow students. And something very important, a lot of the teachers told us when we were developing this product that one of the big challenges they had, that there's always a group of students in their class that are afraid to speak up. In fact, my daughter is one of those students. She refuses to speak up in class because she is always embarrassed to speak in front of the whole classroom, and that's all you can do within Zoom. So we added one-on-one discussion technology, so a teacher or TA can click on a student and have a private discussion without leaving Zoom and allow them to directly connect with the student, not just for the teachers or the TAs, but imagine for special education, if there are IEP support within the class, they can now directly talk with the students and provide that support during class live. You know, one of the things that always amazed me was you had basically every class in K through 12 moving online, and yet none of that could be recorded because FERPA requires that you are not allowed to record students under the age of 18 in a class. So if you missed the class, you couldn't go back and watch it, even though it was all digital. We modified the Zoom recording so we could go ahead and record classes and block out all the students. So now if a K through 12 student misses class, they can actually go back and watch what the teacher has and present all that content without violating FERPA guidelines. And we also tackled attendance. You know, we heard from a lot of instructors that they spent the first 5 to 10 minutes of every single class just looking across the screen and trying to figure out who was there and not there. But this is all online. So automatically our system can determine who came and who left, whether they're tardy and they're late, and track attendance across the classes. And since we know who's there, we also know who's not there. We just list right on the participation list for the teacher what students are absent. And the most hated feature of the product is loose focus tracking. We can now tell if the student has class as the primary application up on their desktop. Now, that doesn't mean they're not paying attention. They could very easily be just looking at an email or watching something else, but still have class up and they're paying attention. But it just is another indicator for the teacher to know whether the students are fully engaged and paying attention. And we also solve the Zoom bombing problem. If a student logs in that our system doesn't recognize, no other student can hear or see them. They can still see what's going on with the teacher and the TAs can see them. And then the teacher can start the class and the TA can go over to the student and say, oh, Kyle, I recognize you. Let me go ahead and verify you. And we'll drop a cookie on his computer. Next time he can log in, no problem. Or if he doesn't belong in the class, they can have a one-on-one discussion, find out where he does belong, remove him from class, and he can't log back in. And we're adding proctoring capabilities too. You know, there's a lot of great proctoring solutions out there on the market, but they're a little bit tedious to use or you know, require a larger setup, and so they're usually saved for just big midterms or finals. Well, we put proctoring in the hands of the teachers. With just the clicking a button, you can not only see what's going on the student's face, but what's going on their desktop. And just like they'd walk around a classroom and just check out the desks of the students to see, just to make sure that they're nothing disingenuous going on, they can do it not only to make sure there's no cheating, but to actually pull up the screen live if a student needs help. Just like they might lean over a desk and say, okay, I see what you're doing wrong here, let me help you out. They now can do that online within Zoom. And we have a whole bunch of seating charts. Zoom calls them views. You're familiar with the speaker view and gallery view within Zoom. We added alphabetical view. We list all of the students in alphabetical order by last name or first name. Now, of course, if you have a class that's 30, 50, 100, or 300 students, now finally you can find those students on the page to be able to interact with them. And probably one of the most popular features in our software, hand raise view. We list the students in order by which they raise their hand. Teachers have told us that this makes it possible for them to actually engage with the students because they know, oh, I need to call on Lindsay before we get too far ahead because she raised her hand, and before I move on to another topic, I want to make sure I address all of the questions that the class has. And we are tracking how long each student speaks. And so then you can turn on participation view and students highlighted in red are talking below average, yellow average, and green above average. And this is great as a marker in that it lets the instructors know which students they should call on to make sure that everyone's participating in the class. And we've spoken with a few schools that don't want the students to be able to see into each other's houses, so they have a privacy view the teacher can turn on, so the teacher and TAs can see everybody, but the students can't see each other. And some instructors have told us they want to turn this on during exam time, because apparently kids are coming up with new ways of cheating by just signaling to each other over the live video feeds. And of course, Zoom has some great immersive views, and we're adding a bunch of different school scenarios to make it more interactive. I mean, I know this looks a little bit bitmoji and a little bit cartoonish, but when you hold a class like this, it actually weirdly makes you feel like you're back in the class. It's almost like a virtual reality experience, much better than the typical grid view. And lastly, we built in a bunch of class management tools. So we have a full gradebook built into Zoom. And of course, if you're using a gradebook that's another standard platform, this can easily be exported. We use LTI to integrate with your backend gradebooks. And one of the things I'm the most excited about is the dashboard. I spoke with a number of presidents and superintendents of schools and principals, and they said that they spent part of every single day going into a couple of classes just to hear how the teachers were doing. And it was hard because they could no longer walk around campus or walk through the halls. And it was hard for them to judge. But here, we're tracking not only how long the teacher's holding class for, but how long the teacher speaks for, how long the students speak for, how long every individual student speaks for, how many students have raised their hand, how many have given feedback, how they did on the exam, and how long it took them to complete that exam. And we not only have our own reports, but we dump all that to a separate S3 server so that the schools themselves can use Tableau or other big data processing products to really do some detailed analysis on what's happening live in the class. I'm excited for what this is going to do, not just for online learning, but for learning overall. We're finally getting detailed analysis of what happens in the classroom and across classrooms, and I think that can really be an improvement for education. Now, our product just came out about 8 weeks ago. It's available on Mac, Windows, iPad, Android, and Chromebook. And it's an incredible product on mobile as well. It almost looks like the future of learning when you can realize you can hold an entire class in just the palm of your hands with an iPad or Android tablet. Each school gets their own URL, so you might be used at harvard.class.com, where your students and faculty can go to download class or log into their institutions. And when we listed all of those things, when I started talking that instructors do in the physical classroom, the idea behind class was to bring all of those things online. Because when you're talking about this next generation of e-learning, when you're talking about what's going to happen after COVID, it's really about how do we continue to replicate this physical classroom experience in an online environment. You know, I'm reflecting back when I talk with my own kids about just what's going on with ordering food. And I explained to them, when I grew up, you could only order a pizza or Chinese food in your house. And they said, that's so crazy, because now, of course, you can order every single restaurant. You know, even the most fancy restaurants will deliver right to your house. And obviously, post-COVID, none of that's going back. It's not like all the restaurants are going to shut down and say we're not delivering anymore. So similarly, that's what I think about what's going to happen with online learning. You can't undo the fact that hundreds of thousands of teachers and millions of students have now taken online classes. And maybe it's not for everybody, but it's certainly for a very large part of the conversation and a large part of the student body that, for them, this is a very successful and active way for them to further their education. In fact, in Montgomery County, where I'm from, they're putting together a fully virtual K-12 school next year. Not just for COVID, but I think they're going to look to extend this long-term because this is a great solution for students that either maybe are better educated at home or maybe in school districts that aren't as strong in other areas and they can always have an online option. And the idea of class was to help schools take that first step forward to really replicate what instructors could do in person online. And the reason that's important is because teachers want to take those online skills want to take their in-classroom skills online without having to learn a whole new methodology of teaching. And if I told you today that most classes are being taught online and teachers can't take attendance, hand out an assignment, give a quiz, grade work, or talk one-on-one with students, you would wonder how are they being as successful as they otherwise would in engaging the students. And so we focused on bringing all those things online so that the teachers can focus on orchestrating the classroom, inspiring learning, and engaging their students. And I truly think that this is going to be the future of education. I think the class is going to be at the forefront of this. Zoom has become the standard e-learning platform, not just here in the United States, but around the world. When you ask students what they're learning on, most schools, whether it's K-12, higher ed, or graduate schools, are using Zoom and virtual meeting technology. And we've now trained everyone in how to take an online class. And maybe it's not for everybody, but nonetheless, over time it's going to get better. Over time it's going to fundamentally change the pace of education, and class is going to be at the forefront of that. So I want to thank all of you for letting me share a little bit about what we think of online learning and the future of this type of technology. And we're available afterwards or our booth outside if you have more questions or you'd like to continue the conversation. Thank you very much, everybody.